What is your name, please?
My name is Ted Geisel.
Come along with me in search of Dr. Seuss.
We'll try to catch him if we can.
He's out there on the loose.
Come along with me in search of Dr. Seuss. I know that we will find him. It'll be a cinch. We'll ask the Grinch.
Ask the Grinch.
Soon he'll be within our reach. Ask the Snitchers on the bench.
You're off to great places. Today is your day.
Your mom is waiting.
So get on your way.
Oh, the places we'll go in search of Dr. Seuss. The places we'll go. Come along with me in search of Dr. Seuss.
Free your mind.
Don't lag behind.
Have fun as much as choose.
Come along with me in search of Dr. Seuss. Maybe we can find him if we ask the cat.
Ask the cat.
In the hat.
In the hat. We'll search high.
And we'll search low.
Oh, the places we will go.
Hello. Is this the home of Dr. Seuss?
Yeah.
Great. My name is Kathy Lane.
Yeah.
I'm on assignment from a newspaper. The Ferncrest Times. Ah! Oh my gosh! What is that? Oh my. This is good. This is great. Yes. Very nice.
Not good, not great, not nice. Shameful. But exactly what I would have expected of a journalist.
Listen, I'm very sorry. I just have this demanding city editor, and today she's demanding a new angle on the world of Dr. Seuss. Oops, spaghetti sauce.
Huh? Can't have it!
Hey, the media's snooping around. Tomorrow, Seuss World.
Ride Horton the elephant. Eat a Grinch burger.
Good, new man.
You're absolutely right. Excuse me.
Don't you have a library at the newspaper? Many articles have been written about Dr. Seuss.
I read every article that's ever been written. What I need now is the inside scoop. Please? For us? Huh?
Okay.
Okay?
For the press.
Okay.
A quick look around, and then...
Listen, I'm not moving in. I have a deadline, okay? All right, let's go.
This was his workspace. His drawings. His desk. Get the feeling? Now, scat.
Okay, great. That was very informative. Thank you very much. Oh, this is good. Okay. And you are? What's your name? I need to quote the source.
Not important who I am.
You don't understand the newspaper business. I need your name, okay? Credit a source. Read my lips. Maybe you're right. I don't need a source. That's the idea, source. Nice hat. Oh, look. Nice book. Open a book. Open your imagination.
No.
Dr. Seuss.
No.
What?
No, not that way. No.
What?
I like nonsense. It wakes up the brain cells. Fantasy is a necessary ingredient in living. It's a way of looking at life through the wrong end of a telescope, which is what I do, and that enables you to laugh at all of life's realities.
You were looking for a story that would catapult you out of Ferncrest.
How did you know I wanted to get out of here?
Juggling the obvious. It's what we do here.
Well, here now isn't where here was when I came here. So why don't we start with what rather than where? For instance, what is the real story on Dr. Seuss?
This is the real story. There's no turning back now.
Woo!
What most people don't realize is that he devoted his life to fighting religious, racial, and social injustice. In his younger days, he did this through his political cartoons using the sledgehammer approach.
I like this. What is this about?
This is one of his political cartoons from PM Magazine, an attack on Hitler's racism. So that cartoon was to one day become the Smeeches. Over here, please.
Okay, little pink boat, pink sand, red trees, very good. Cat print. No. No.
Why don't we pause here?
How nice.
Madame.
Thank you. The Sneetches. Now, the star-belly Sneetches had bellies with stars. The plain-belly Sneetches had none upon Mars.
We're the best kind of Sneetch on the beaches.
The star-belly Sneetches kept them away, never let them come near. And that's how they treated the plain-bellied Sneetches year after year. That is, until a stranger approached in the strangest of cars.
My friends, I have seen they've been treating you mean. My name is Sylvester McMonkey McBean. I know precisely why you're so unhappy, and that I can fix. I'm the fix-it-up chappy. By my new patent process of polar potoxis, of the inner subnuclear noose bomb no-goxis, you'll get a star like the star-bellied Sneetch.
A star? Here?
Yes, my friend, there. And the first to go through gets the trip at half fare. Thank you.
It works! When the plain-belly Sneetches popped out, they had stars. They actually did. They had stars upon theirs.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are faced with a most awkward dilemma. We're the true star bellies. We had them first. We're still the best Sneetches, and they're still the worst.
Belly stars, my dear friends, are no longer in style. And I'll have yours off in a very short while in my wondrous machine, which eradicates stars. Then you won't look like Sneetches who have them on Mars. How original!
How distinctive!
How exclusive!
All the rest of that day on those wild, screaming beaches, the Fix-It-Up Chappy kept fixing up Sneetches. Off again, on again, in again, out again, through the machines, they raced round and about again, changing their stars every minute or two until neither the plane nor the starbillies knew whether this one was that one or that one was this one or which one was what one or what one was who. Then, when every last cent of their money was spent, the Fix-It-Up Chappy packed up and he went. And he laughed as he drove his car up the beach.
They never will learn. No, you can't teach a Sneetch.
But McBean was quite wrong. I'm happy to say that the Sneetches got really quite smart on that day. That day they decided that Sneetches are Sneetches. And no kind of Sneetch is the best on the beach. That day all the Sneetches forgot about stars and whether they had one or not upon Mars. Great story. Excuse me. Question time. Did Dr. Seuss experience any of this prejudice firsthand?
In some ways, he was a lot like the Sneetches.
What, he had a star in his belly? Just joking.
No. Outcast. Right. He was raised in America, but his parents were German, which made him an easy target during the First World War. He was chased home by the local kids yelling, "Kaiser!" and bouncing lumps of coal off his head.
You know, my readers are going to want to know a lot more about his early life. What else?
I have a hunch you're going to have some very satisfied readers. Oh.
Hello, what's going on?
How did you... Just hold on. That must hurt. Are you all right?
Was that ever wrong, Hunch? I'm getting too old for this. Mr. Hunch.
Is... What? Hunches and Bunches! Oh, it's you! Look, I'm embarrassed. I didn't recognize... Where did you come from?
I was fidgeting in my chair, trying to follow a hunch. It's awfully awful. You can't make up your mind. Do you want to kick a football? Or sit there on your behind?
I will. Oh, no.
Do you want to go out skating?
Skating?
Fly a kite?
Sure.
Or climb a tree?
No, Pa.
Do you want to eat a pizza?
Okay.
Or take a bath? Or watch TV? Oh. Well, I followed a down hunch. So, have you met any other friends of Dr. Seuss?
You mean like the cat in the...
Cat! He's not here, is he?
No, unless he's in there.
He's too mischievous for me. I got a hunch he's not in here.
You're right.
I've got a munch hunch.
For what? Green eggs and ham. Green eggs. I do not like green eggs and ham. I would not like them here or there. I would not like them anywhere.
I have a hunch you might just change your mind.
I think so.
Oh, pineapple butterscotch. Ding dang doo.
A ding a who, a what?
Three chicken croquettes of library paste with peanut shucks pickled and spiced and baked at 600 degrees, then iced.
Tempting, very tempting.
Slop with a cherry on top.
No, it's okay.
Green edge spinach. Ah, this is for me. Goose juice or moose juice?
These are the choices. No crayon apple. Oh, no, goose juice. Goose is good. Okay.
Moose juice. I got it.
Mr. Hunch, now that it's just the two of us, you know, breaking bread together, I thought maybe I could, well, just feel free to ask you just a couple of questions, if you don't mind. Like, for instance, I heard Dr. Seuss was a very shy, retiring man. Is this true?
No.
No?
No.
Sure?
No. He often described himself as part cat in the hat, wily, a jokester, and part Grinch.
Mr. Hunch, tell me everything you know and start from the beginning.
Oh, movie's time. Ready?
Yes!
Ted Geisel was born in Springfield, Massachusetts, 1904, and lived near Mulberry Street. His father, Theodore, taught him the importance of self-belief and determination. His dad worked 35 years at the Kombach and Geisel Brewery. The day he was promoted to president, prohibition was declared. So he turned to designing the Springfield parks and running the zoo. He told young Ted, no matter how small the task, always strive for perfection. His mother, Henrietta Seuss, gave her son his sense of humor and the name Seuss. She read to him when he was a baby, and by the age of 6, he was reading the classics. He spent as much time in the Carnegie Library as he did at school. He loved Charles Dickens, Robert Louis Stevenson, but his favorite was Jonathan Swift.
Here's a book inspired by his early family life, The Gilligot's Pool. I have a hunch there's more here than meets the eye.
Young man, you're sort of a fool. You'll never catch fish in McGilligot's pool. The pool is too small, and you might as well know it. When people have junk, here's the place that they throw it. If you sat 50 years with your worms and your wishes, you'd grow a long beard long before you'd catch fishes.
It may be you're right. I've been here 3 hours without one single bite. There might be no fish, but again, well, there might. This might be a pool like I've read of in books, connected to one of those underground brooks. This might be a river, now mightn't it be, connecting McGilligan's pool with the sea. Then maybe some fish might be swimming towards me. I might catch a thin fish, I might catch a stout fish. I might catch a short or a long, long drawn out fish. I might catch a fish with a pinwheel-like tail. I might catch a fish who has fins like a sail. I might catch some young ones, some high-jumping friskers. I might catch an old one with long, flowing whiskers. I might catch a fish with a long, curly nose. I might catch a fish like a rooster that crows. I might catch a fish with a checkered belly, or even a fish made of strawberry jelly. Who wants to catch small ones like mackerel or trout? Say, I'll catch a sawfish with such a long snout that he needs an assistant to help him about. From the world's deepest ocean, from way down below, from down in the mud where the deep divers go, from down in the mire and the muck and the murk, I might catch some fish who are all going glork. Oh, the sea is so full of a number of fish. If a fellow is patient, he might get his wish. And that's why I think that I'm not such a fool when I sit here and fish in McElligot's pool.
This book is dedicated to T.R. Geisel of Springfield, Massachusetts, his father, the world's greatest authority on blackfish, fiddler crabs, and deagle trout. This must be the deagle trout, right?
One day, his father took him trout fishing, and both of them bragged to family and friends about how many fish they were going to catch.
And they probably came home with bupkis, right?
Not a minnow. So on the way home, they stopped off at Deagle's fish hatchery, scooped up the biggest mess of fish they could for $2, and nobody ever knew the difference.
Nobody ever knew the difference till now. I love this Deagle trout stuff.
Look! Put that golden on the river, and I throw one, throw one, throw one.
Well, Horton the elephant. Horton hatches the egg. Side Maisie, a lazy bird hatching an egg.
I'm tired, and I'm bored, and I've kinks in my legs from sitting, just sitting here day after day. It's work. How I hate it. I'd much rather play. If I could find someone, I'd fly away. Free.
Then, Horton the elephant passed by your tree.
On the river, and I throw one, throw one, throw four.
Uh-huh. Huh? You've nothing to do, and I do need a rest. Would you like to sit on the egg in my nest?
Me on your egg? Why, it doesn't make sense. Your egg is so small, ma'am, and I'm so immense.
I'll hurry right back. Why, I'll never be missed.
Very well. Since you insist, I'll stay and be faithful. I mean what I say.
Sang out Maisie and fluttered away. Then carefully, tenderly, gently he crept up the trunk to the nest where the little egg slept. And he sat all that day, and he kept the egg warm. And he sat all that night through a terrible storm. And then came the winter, the snow, and the sleet, and icicles hung from his trunk and his feet.
I meant what I said. And I said what I meant. An elephant's faithful. 100%. Gazoon time.
So poor Horton sat there the whole winter through, and then came the springtime with troubles anew. His friends gathered round and they shouted with glee.
Look, Horton the elephant's up in a tree.
They laughed and they laughed. Then they all ran away. And Horton was lonely. He wanted to play. But while Horton sat there, so faithful, so kind, three hunters came sneaking up softly behind.
He heard the men's footsteps. He turned with a start. A rifle was aiming right straight at his heart. Did he run? No, not Horton. He stayed on that nest. He held his head high, he threw out his chest, and he looked at the hunters and he said, plain as day,
shoot if you must, but I won't run away.
Well, take him away. Why, he's terribly funny.
We'll sell them back home to a circus for money.
Sold to a circus, then week after week, they showed him to people at 10 cents a peep. Dawdling along way up high in the sky, who, of all people, should chance to fly by? And she swooped from the clouds through an open tent door.
Good gracious! I've seen you before.
Poor Horton looked up with his face white as chalk. He started to speak, but before he could talk, there rang out the noisiest, ear-splitting squeaks from the egg that he'd sat on for 51 weeks.
My egg! My egg! Why, it's hatching!
It's my egg! You stole it from me! Get off of my nest and get out of my tree!
Poor Horton backed down with a sad, heavy heart. But at that very instant, the egg burst apart. Then Horton the elephant saw something whiz. It had ears and a tail and a trunk just like his.
My goodness! My gracious!
Good heavens, my word!
It's something brand new! It's an elephant boy!
Yes, he meant what he said, and he said what he meant.
And they sent him home happy 100%!
So, what do you think of the Horton story?
I think it's great. I mean, it's true, there's more to being a mom than the actual laying of the egg, if you will. Plus, you don't have to give birth to be a good parent.
Horton is a fine example of courage and loyalty, two themes that run throughout Dr. Seuss's work.
Where did he learn how to draw?
Well, there were art lessons in high school, but the teacher wanted him to draw the world as it is, and Seuss wanted to draw things as he saw them. So he walked out of class and began drawing for the school paper. But it was in Dartmouth College where he really began to draw and to marry words to images.
Now, I know he enrolled in Dartmouth College to become a teacher.
College is for 10, Bob. He wasn't the greatest student, but he had a great sense of humor. It even helped him become editor of the school paper, the Jack O'Lantern.
The Roaring Twenties must have been an excellent time for comedy writers.
Oh, may we! Lots of good material, like the new jazz, the forerunner to the Beatles, and the new liquor laws.
Wait a minute. Now, where did he get the name Dr. Seuss?
Remember, this was the era of Prohibition.
Right.
One night, he, 10 students, and a pint of gin were in his dorm room when the local chief of police walked in.
Seuss was busted for cocktails?
When the dean discharged him as editor of the Jack-O-Lantern, he assumed his mother's maiden name, Seuss.
Seuss.
And continued submitting cartoons.
Uh-huh.
But it wasn't his only pen name. In later years, there were 13 books under the name T. Lessig.
What? What?
Geisel spelled backwards.
What a kook.
Wait up.
You were the cat in the hat.
The cat in the hat?
It's her. She's here.
Hello. Where is here?
Oh, here is where Dr. Seuss spent a great deal of his life.
The
world
of
advertising.
Oh, commercials.
Those two.
My dear, you've never heard of
Flit.
Flit is cheese crackers.
Mm.
No. Flit is... an insecticide.
You've got it.
I got it. Ta-da! The insecticide of the day. Huh? Thanks to Dr. Seuss, of course, who created the ads for Flit for 17 years. From newspapers to animated cartoons.
Quick, Henry! The Flit!
Ring a bell?
No. Sorry.
Oh, boy!
Oh, boy!
There we are.
How about the Seuss Navy? In the 1930s, it was the largest navy in the world.
The Seuss Navy? You're joking.
No, no joke. The Seuss Navy was his promotional brainstorm. He created it for Standard Oil's Esso Marine, a lubricant for boats.
He printed up diplomas and gave them
to prominent people. Within months, he was besieged with requests
from celebrities, even the Standard Oil fleet, even the Queen Mary.
Stop, please.
Going too fast?
No, no, no. It's just the swaying. Just making me a little ill. Now, according to my notes, after dark... Yep. Oh. After Dartmouth is when he went into advertising, right?
Absolutely!
Not.
Well, where did he go?
He went to Oxford to study and experience the beauty of...
Literature.
One for the lady.
Woman.
However, the analysis of Gothic literature didn't... interest him. He wanted to... Oh, yeah. He wanted to experience life rather than dissect it.
In one class, he met an American student, Helen Palmer.
Whom he later married.
It was a very boring class on the punctuation of Shakespeare's play, King Lear.
Teddy, that's a very lovely flying cow you've drawn.
Thank you, Helen.
Stop burying yourself in Shakespeare's semicolons and go out and see the world.
Hello?
Let's move on.
So.
Thank you.
He quits Oxford and he spends several months traveling Europe.
Now, answer me this. Did he ever actually acquire his doctorate?
Absolutely!
Not...
I hate you.
But he acquires a whole new philosophy about life. He decides that most adults take life much too seriously, and he vows to retain a child's perspective on life. View the world without a social pressure gauge. Let the imagination run free.
React and experience from an honest gut level. Enjoy a good laugh. Ah! Woo-hoo-hoo! Yeah!
1927, New York. He finally lands a job at Judge Magazine. He marries Helen, but due to the recession, his salary drops to $40 a week. Judge Magazine becomes his real graduate school. It's where he learns his craft and develops a style and a gallery of characters that become his repertory company for life.
He creates Boys and Beasties, a series of scientific satires, like...
reading music at sight.
How to eject a cow from your apartment.
The dangers of a small lap.
Science by Seuss. So he signs them Dr. Seuss.
That's where doctor came from. Hallelujah.
One day in drawing a cartoon, he tosses a coin to see which bug killer he'll use in the caption. Darn it all! Another dragon. Just after I sprayed the whole castle with flit.
The wife of a flit ad exec sees the cartoon and suggests Dr. Seuss be signed to a high-paying position in Standard Oil's advertising department. And so he becomes a commercial artist for Standard Oil.
But money in the bank doesn't make him happy. He soon regrets seeing his cartoons and advertising slogans disappear within a week, so he leaves.
Brave man. It's very difficult freelancing during depression. There's something to be said for a steady job.
Two for the lady.
Woman. He rejoins his friends at Standard Oil. But in his contract, he has one small loophole that is to change his life.
Writing children's books.
Grand slam, home run!
Really?
Bam! Bam!
Bam!
He experiments with two children's books without much success. However, in 1936, he and his wife Helen are returning from a European vacation.
Aboard the passenger liner MS Kung Hong.
In a blistering storm.
To take his mind off the rocking and the rolling.
The rolling and the rocking. He writes a story.
Oh, I can't rock and roll anymore. Just one moment, please.
The rhythm of the ship's engines echoed throughout the liner. Da 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 da
And to think that I saw it on Mulberry Street. And to think that I saw it on Mulberry Street.
Okay.
And to think that I saw it on Mulberry Street. Bon voyage, young lady.
May the wind be in your sail.
Yeah, the wind up your sail. Bye-bye.
And to think that I saw it on Mulberry Street.
And I'm Mulberry drinking on Pinkberry Street. And I lick him, I saw it on Hunkerman Puke. And I saw it, I drink it. I think I read it on Pickleford Street. Oh, my goodness. Excuse me, can I share this bench with you? I've just had a very rough trip, don't ask. Oh, that's better. Hi, I'm Kathy.
My name's Marco.
What's the matter, Marco?
Whenever I leave home to walk to school, my dad always says to me, you know, Marco, son, keep your eyelids open and see what you're going to see.
And what's wrong with that?
When I tell him where I've been and what I think I've seen, he always looks at me and sternly says, ah, your eyesight's much too keen. Stop telling such outlandish tales and stop turning minnows into whales. Hmm. Now, what can I see when I get home tonight? All that I've noticed except my own two feet was just a horse and wagon on Mulberry Street.
Hmm. What would you like to see?
Well, that's nothing to tell of, you know. That won't do, of course. Just a broken-down wagon that's drawn by a horse. That can't be my story.
No.
That's only a start.
Yep.
I'll say that a zebra was pulling that cart.
That's a story that no one can beat. When you say that you saw it on Mulberry Street.
Yeah. Yes, the zebra's fine, but I think it's a shame. Such a marvelous beast with a cart that's so tame.
Mm.
The story would really be better to hear. The driver I saw wore a charioteer. yeah, golden blue chariot, something to me, rumbling like thunder down Mulberry Street. It won't do at all because a zebra's much too small.
A reindeer is better. It's fast and it's sleek. It looked mighty smart on old Mulberry Street.
Yeah, well, hold on a minute. There's something wrong. A reindeer hates the way it feels to pull a thing that runs on wheels. He'd be much happier instead if he could pull a fancy sled. A reindeer and a sleigh. But it isn't too late to make one little change. A sleigh and an elephant.
Now there's something strange.
Yeah, I'll pick one with plenty of power and size. A blue one with plenty of fun in his eyes. Say, it does make a story that no one can beat when I say that I saw it on Mulberry Street.
And then, just to give it a little more tone, a Raja with rubies perched high on a throne.
Yes, but he looks something grand with a great big brass band. Me is this. Mulberry Street just runs into bliss.
Unless there's something that you can fix up, there'll be an awful traffic mix-up.
It takes police to do the trick, and it'll never crash now. And they'll race at top speed with Sergeant Mulvaney himself in the lead. And the mayor's there. He thinks it is grand, and he raises his hat as they dash by the stand. With the roar of its motor, an airplane appears. Now! When it dumps out confetti while everyone cheers. Yeah!
That is a story that no one can beat.
I say that I saw it on Mulberry Street. Wow. There's so much to tell. I just couldn't begin. Dad'll look at me sharply and he'll pull at his chin and frown at me sternly from there in his seat. Oh, was there nothing to look at? No people to greet? Did nothing excite you or make your heart beat?
Hmm? And what will you say?
Nothing, and I'll say, growing red as a beet, but a plain horse and wagon on Mulberry Street.
Hey, Marco, babe.
Yeah?
You got a great imagination, all right? Don't change. Come here. Get out of here. Stay as sweet as you are. Don't grow old.
Be like my dad.
Well, you know, you got to give him a break. Sometimes when you get to be an adult, other things become important, and you forget how to laugh. You have responsibilities. You have built. Bye-bye.
Good morning, ma'am. Sergeant Mulvaney at your service.
Mulvaney.
Are you all right, miss?
Miss, I'm fine. I'm fine. I'm just a little confused. I mean, why would Marco's father purposely want him to be boring?
That's not so simple now, is it? Marco's father was not a bad man. Dr. Seuss created him because he knew that adults and teachers didn't realize how they could smother the imagination. Smother it rather than mother it.
I don't imagine that was an easy sell.
But that was the challenge, don't you see? He knew that it was something that people did not want to hear, but he was determined to push it through. When Irish eyes are smiling, sure it's like a morning spring. And then in dip. Well, what do I have here? I have the manuscript of Mulberry Street.
For me? How sweet. Thank you.
Let's say for now. Now be a pal and walk through that door.
You're not serious. Hello? There's nothing on the other side of the door.
Oh, is that Marco's father that I be after hearing? Remember, nothing can be anything or something or everything where Dr. Seuss is involved.
Okay, so I guess this is goodbye.
He's in a meeting. He'll get right back
not
to you.
Us, really. No, thank you. Nope.
And you are, we'll call you.
It's not trying.
Hold on. Oh, whoa.
Hey. Let me see your badge. What was that all about?
With Mulberry Street in hand, he went through that door 27 times, and every publisher rejected it.
Well, at this point, I think he should have been thinking career change.
But he had no grand delusions about what others would think of his work. Oh, no. He knew that that one solitary voice was still out there, and he was determined to find it. He'd pick himself up, brush himself down, and begin again. And on that happy note, I'll be off. But you have ahead of you a walloping world of wonders. Enjoy it.
Wait. Watch out for the door. On second thought, be my guest.
If you believe in something, my dear, never give up on it.
Sergeant, what? Well, hello. So glad you could drop by. Where have you been?
Well, you were with Mulvaney.
Yes, and he was lovely.
Did he do his famous revolving door trick?
Yes. I found it quite exhilarating.
Oh, really? Mm-hmm. It was mine originally, you know.
Oh, was it? Now, don't be jealous. He was just quite taken with the great success of Mulberry Street. Apparently, he was featured in it.
Well, that's Mulvaney. Mm-hmm. It was a success, but not great enough to allow Dr. Seuss the opportunity to quit the ad world.
You're kidding, still? What does the man have to do? Oh, I don't know about you, but about this time I'm thinking, okay, bye-bye, let's go, all right?
Scaredy cat. Yep. It was that kind of time.
Yeah.
Cat? Astrophic.
I want to go, really. I really gotta.
World War II had just broken out in Europe. Dr. Seuss was about to take a 7-year break from the ad world and his writing.
Oh, I know this. This is one of his political cartoons from PM Magazine. You showed me this something like this in the tower, right?
I see you've been paying attention.
Dr. Seuss felt Hitler was a real threat to the entire world and had to be stopped. These were the only angry pictures he ever drew, but he felt it necessary to take that org sledgehammer approach.
Oh, I know this. Maisie, Horton, and the elephant bird, right?
The GOP, or Republican Party, and the isolationists had complained that the U.S. should stay out of the war. Seuss drew their squawking child, the Gopstritch.
Don't get involved! Don't get involved!
These images are so intense, I would have never expected this from Dr. Seuss.
Good material for your story.
Excellent material. You know what's amazing is that he combined, like, real-life political figures with his animated characters, right?
Many of these friends were to have another life in his children's books.
Yertle the Turtle.
Dr. Seuss was warning factory workers who produce military weaponry that if they didn't move faster than turtles, we'd never see victory.
What is going on?
Maybe we better duck in here.
Hello? Hello?
I don't think there's anyone here.
Hello, is anyone here?
What are you?
You are gone again. Okay. All right. All right, carry on. I got a front-page story right in here. Hello? Room? I am friendly, and I'd like to speak to you.
Well, if you want to shed some light on the situation, pull the cord.
Okay.
That's it.
Cord.
Hey, there you go. Welcome to the Ford Fox editing room. I'm over here on the shelf. Right over here.
This is amazing.
Here.
You?
No, not the mouse. Here. Hey, that's Captain Geisel with the Army's documentary filmmaking unit. Come on, over here. Little closer. Left, left, left. There you go.
What, the radio?
Don't get too excited. Yeah, the radio.
Okay, you're not gonna, like, ask me for an oil can or something, are you?
Very funny. No, you're listening to the Voice of America. We started in World War II and we're still on the air. You know, like Soul Train. So what can I do for you?
Well, you can start by giving me the scoop on everything related to Dr. Seuss in wartime.
Okay, dollface.
Yeah?
Yeah, because I like you. Maybe later I'll show you my transmitter. Now, over on the desk, there's some scripts. Read one.
Okay.
Yeah, take a look at it.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Listen, I saw a microphone over there, and I...
Everybody loves a microphone. Go ahead, enjoy yourself. Yep, right over there. Knock yourself out.
Testing.
Hey, Miss Fitzgerald!
As World War II began, Dr. Seuss became Captain Geisel working at Hollywood's Fort Fox under Colonel Frank Capra, director of It's a Wonderful Life. Geisel produced a series of indoctrination films that earned him a Legion of Merit award.
It's a very impressive award.
In 1944, he was transferred to Europe, and while serving in France, he commandeered a jeep to observe frontline action. He ended up in a quaint little town named Baston.
Wasn't that quaint? It was the Battle of the Bulge, one of the most important battles of the war.
In 1946, a Warner Brothers release was written by Ted and Helen Geisel. It won an Academy Award Best Documentary Short Subject. That's very impressive.
You're telling me. You want to see some? Flick that projector on, please. Now, here are excerpts from that documentary. It's called Hitler Lives. Yeah, put it on right there. Now, who would think that Dr. Seuss would have done something like this?
War with Germany ends in victory. Victory leads to peace. Sometimes, sometimes not. 1945. The problem now is future peace. Nazi Germany today appears to be beaten. Hitler out. Swastikas gone. It's still enemy country. We must still be alert. Somewhere in Germany are the SS guards out of uniform, the stormtroopers by the thousands, the 2 million ex-Nazi officials out of power, but still thinking and thinking about next time. However free of the Nazi party they may seem, they cannot come back into the civilized world just by sticking their hand out and saying, "We're sorry." Not sorry they caused the war, but only sorry they lost it. Someday the Nazis of Germany might be cured of the super race disease, the world conquest disease, but this must be proven beyond a shadow of a doubt. The voices of millions of dead cry out, this time we must not have died in vain. We are determined that the Nazi plans for world conquest shall stop here and now. Right here in America, advocates of fascism live amongst us. They wear many guises as they continue with Hitler's aims and purposes, spreading the propaganda of race hatred and violence. No small men must be permitted to break down the democratic ideals of the youth of our nation, where children of all races can meet on common ground, inspired by a heritage of clean living and the principles of fair play and honor. The people themselves must so earnestly desire peace that we will not only demand it, but work for it incessantly. Then only will be created a sound heritage that shall be guaranteed for the sons and daughters of the living and dead, who so truly earn the fruits their children are entitled to reap in the united world of tomorrow, the world of lasting freedom between all nations.
It must have had a major impact in its time.
Well, he didn't want anyone to forget what had happened and what could happen again. An interesting thing. His original drawings of Yertle the Turtle had a little Hitler mustache and wore a Nazi uniform.
Whoa, you're kidding.
What's going on?
Uh-oh.
What's that?
Uh-oh, something's going on. Electrical power. Better get out of here.
Turtle stack, I got pains in my back and knees. How much longer, Your Majesty? I know you're the king, but I gotta complain. The crew down here is in a lot of pain. Up at the top, you're seeing great sights, but down at the bottom, we too have rights.
You hush your mouth.
That's a great deal.
You've no right to talk to the world's highest turtle. I rule over clouds, over land, over sea, and there's nothing, no nothing, that's higher than me. Nothing.
While he was shouting, he saw with surprise the moon of the evening started to rise over his head in the darkening sky.
What's that? Say, what is that thing that dares to be higher than Yertle the King? I'll call some more turtles and I'll stack them right onto heaven. I think I'll need about 5,000. 607.
As Yertle the Turtle King lifted his hand and started to order and give the command,
that plain little turtle, whose name was just Mac, decided he'd taken enough, and he had.
And that plain little lad got a little bit mad. And that plain little Mac did a plain little thing.
He burped.
King of the mud.
All you can see. Turtle must. All time.
you know, turtles, of course. All turtles are free, as turtles are free, as turtles should be.
I thought you'd never get here.
Well, I'm here. Where am I?
Welcome to the 1950s. Well. Dr. Seuss was back writing ad copy and creating children's books in his spare time.
Huh?
The drawing was easy for him. It was the words that kept him up at night. He threw over 95% of his work away.
Well, he was a perfectionist. I can relate to that. Okay, so 20 years later, does he finally get the confidence to, like, leave the ad world and become a full-time writer?
Acquiring confidence isn't always easy. But in 1957, things changed. John Hersey of Life magazine challenged Dr. Seuss to write a primer for classrooms. Hersey felt that school kids were bored reading about Dick, Jane, but...
I remember those books. Exciting rules and personal hygiene tips for children. No, not fun.
So, Dr. Seuss took the dare and began to write a book kids could read using only 225 basic words. And after 9 months...
The Cat in the Hat. The sun did not shine. It was too wet to play. So we sat in the house all that cold, cold, wet day. I sat there with Sally. We sat there, we two, and I said,
"Oh, I wish we had something to do."
And then something went bump! No. How that bump made us jump. We looked, and we saw him step in on the mat. We looked, and we saw him.
The Cat in the Hat.
He said to us,
"Why do you sit there like that? I know it's wet and the sun is not sunny. We're gonna have fun and lots of good fun. That's funny."
Then Sally and I did not know what to say. Our mother was out of the house for the day. But our fish said,
"No, no.
Make that cat go away. He should not be here. He should not be about. He should not be here when your mother is out."
"Now, now, have no fear. Have no fear," said the cat.
"My tricks are not bad," said the Cat in the Hat. "We can have lots of good fun if you wish.
Come on up there. This is a lot of good fun."
Okay, wait.
Oh, you see, that's why you can have a lot of good fun.
With a game that I call Up, Up, Up with Fish.
look at me now. It's fun to have fun. You have to know how.
I can hold up the cup and the milk and the cake.
Oh, and all of these books and a fish on a rake. I can hold a toy ship and a little toy man. And look, with my tail, I can hold up a red fan.
Mandacity. I can fan with the fan. I can hop on the ball. And that is not all.
No, that's not all.
That's what the cat said. Oh. Then he fell on his head. And a fish came down too. And he fell into a pot. He said,
"Do I like this? Oh, no, I do not. You should not be here when our mother is not. Get out of this house,"
said the fish in the pot.
"I said that. I meant it."
"I know you did."
"Yes."
"I will not go away. I do not wish to go. And so?"
So.
"I will show you another good game that I know." And he ran out, then fast as a fox. The Cat in the Hat came back in with a box. And he got up on top with the tip of his hat. "I call this game Fun in a Box," said the cat. Then out of the box came Thing Two and Thing One.
Thing Two and Thing One.
That's right. These things will not bite you. They just like to have fun. "Now here's a game that they like," said the cat. "They like to fly kites. We can fly the kites. Oh. Look at the kites. You want to fly a kite? No, you see, you can do that. You can fly a kite in the house."
"No, not in the house," said the fish in the pot. "They should not fly kites in a house. They should not. Oh."
Then Sally and I saw them run down the hall. These two things bumped their kites on the wall. Thing Two and Thing One, they ran up, they ran down. On the string of one kite, we saw Mother's new gown. Then our fish said,
"Look, look."
And our fish shook with fear.
"Your mother's on her way home, do you hear? So as fast as you can, think of something to do. You've got to get rid of Thing One and Thing Two."
And I said with my net, "I can get them, I bet. I bet with my net I get those things yet." Then I let down my net. It came down with a plop. I had them at last. Those two things had to stop. And I said to the cat, "Now you do as I say. Now you pack those things up and you take them away.
Oh, dear, said the cat. You do not like our game. Oh, dear, what a shame, what a shame, what a shame. Then he shut up the things in the box with a hook, and the cat went away with a sad kind of look. That is good, said the fish. He's gone away, yes, but your mother will come. She'll find this big mess. And then who was back in the house? Why, the cat. Have no fear of this mess, said the cat in the hat. I always pick up all my playthings, and so I will show you another good trick that I know. And we saw him pick up all the things that were down. He picked up the cake and the rake and the gown and the milk and the strings and the books and the dish and the fan and the cup and the ship and the dish. And he put them away and he said, that's that. And then he was gone with the tip of his hat. Then Mother came in and she said to us two, hey, did you have any fun? Tell me, what did you do? And Sally and I did not know what to say. Should we tell her the things that went on there that day? Should we tell her about it? Now, should we? What should we do? What would you do if your mother asked you?
Cat in the Hat sold over 250,000 copies in the first year.
And if I'm not mistaken, the first time that a cat ever helped establish a publishing company?
Just tell me, did he finally become a full-time writer?
As a matter of fact,
yes.
Just another overnight success story. Overnight, that is, 35 years later.
Cat, hat, ship. Wait a minute. Cat in the Hat never made it to the schoolroom.
Of course not. It made school boards nervous. It made reading too much fun. That book and his next big one.
I frequently think, every now and then, of the glorious fruit of the noble hen. Eggs. E-double-G-S. My knowledge of eggs is tremendously wide. I've eaten them boiled. I've eaten them fried. Poached and churred, deviled and scrambled, tumbled, wombled, wimbled, and wambled.
I've eaten them beaten, swizzled and swizzled. I've known every way that an egg can be guzzled.
What? Thinking of eggs reminds me of Sam, whose favorite dish is green eggs and ham.
I am Sam. Sam I am. I am Sam. Sam I am. Do you like green eggs and ham?
I do not like them, Sam I am. I do not like green eggs and ham.
Would you like them here or there?
I would not like them anywhere.
Would you like them in a house? Would you like them with a mouse?
Not in a house. Not with a mouse. I would not eat them here or there. I would not eat them anywhere. I would not eat green eggs and ham. I do not like them, Sam, I am.
A train, a train, a train, a train. Could you, would you on a train?
Not on a train, not in a tree, not in a car, Sam, let me be.
Stay in the dark. You're in the dark. Would you, could you in the dark?
I wouldn't, could not in the dark.
Would you, could you in the rain?
I would not, could not in the rain. Not in the dark, not on a train.
You do not like them, so you say. Try them, and you may. Try them and you may, I say.
If you will let me be, I will try them, you will see.
Adult is trying something new.
Oh, foray, doll, doray. Green eggs and ham, the best there I am. And Dr. Seuss, he told that story using just 20 words.
Six.
Well, 50 maybe, I don't know. Aha! Top that! Cat in the Hat!
How do you feel?
A little chilly.
Chilly?
Yeah.
Now, who?
Who is almost correct?
And where?
Where is who? As in Whoville. Right down there.
Whoville. The Whoville that the Grinch terrorizes.
Oh.
What?
I need someone to talk to at last.
Oh,
and it was awful.
Oh, I bet.
Oh, God.
Oh,
no,
that's right. What?
And little Cindy Lou.
And she just wanted to get her presents, right?
Oh, she didn't get her presents. And nothing but her is a couple of little presents. I'm sorry.
Breathe.
I'm so sorry.
Come on.
I'm
Let's so sit sorry. Down. I'm sorry. Now sit and tell me the story.
Thank you. I tell you, this is one of his best stories.
The ending where he finally
Wait
gets
a man out who's telling this story.
You.
There it lies, the village of Whoville. It was a serene Christmas Eve, and the snow was gently falling. Every Who down in Whoville liked Christmas a lot, but the Grinch, who lived just north of Whoville, did not. The Grinch hated Christmas, the whole Christmas season. Now, please don't ask why. No one quite knows the reason. But I think that the most likely reason of all may have been that his heart was two sizes too small. He knew that on Christmas morn, all the boys and girls would open up their toys.
There's one thing I hate. All that noise.
Then the Whos, young and old, would sit down to a feast.
I remember Who pudding and rare Who roast beast.
And then they'd do something that he liked least of all.
I remember.
They'd sing.
Fa Who foray.
Fa Who doray. Welcome Christmas. Come this way. Fa
Why, for 53 years he'd put up with it now. But he must stop this Christmas from coming. But how? Then he got an idea.
An awful idea?
The Grinch got a wonderful, awful idea.
I know just what to do. What a great Grinchy trick. With this coat and this hat, I'll look just like Saint Nick. All I need is a reindeer.
So he called his dog Max. Then he took some red thread and he tied a big horn on the top of his head. Then the Grinch said, "Giddy up!" And the sleigh started down toward the homes where the Whos lay a-snooze in their town. All the windows were dark. No one knew he was there. They were all dreaming sweet dreams without care. Then he slid down the chimney, a rather tight pinch.
But if Santa could do it, then so could the Grinch.
Then he slunk to the icebox. He took the Who feast. He took the Who pudding. He took the roast beast. Then he slithered and slunk with a smile most unpleasant around the whole room, and he took every present. And as the Grinch took the tree and he started to shove, he heard a small sound. Like the coo of a dove. He turned around fast and he saw a small Who.
Little Cindy Lou Who.
Who was no more than two.
Santa Claus, why? Why are you taking our Christmas tree?
There's a light on this tree that won't light on one side. So I'm taking it home to my workshop, my dear. I'll fix it up there, then I'll bring it back here.
And the fib fooled the child.
It was a quarter past dawn, all the Whos still abed, all the Whos still a-snooze when he packed up his sled. 3,000 feet up to the top of Mount Crumpet, he rode with his load to the tip-top to dump it.
They're finding out now that no Christmas is coming. They're just waking up. I know just what they'll do. Their mouths will hang open a minute or two, then the Whos down in Whoville will all cry, boo-hoo. That's a noise that I simply must hear.
So he paused, and the Grinch put a hand to his ear. Every Whodun in Whoville, the tall and the small, was singing without any presents at all. Then the Grinch thought of something he hadn't before. Maybe Christmas, he thought, didn't come from a store.
Maybe Christmas, perhaps, means a little bit more. And then what happened?
Well, in Whoville, they say that the Grinch's small heart grew 3 sizes that day. With a smile in his soul, he descended Mount Crumpet, cheerfully blowing hoo-hoo on his trumpet.
And he brought everything back.
All the food for the feast. And he himself, the Grinch, carved the roast beast.
So everything's fine. The village has its Christmas, and he learns a valuable lesson, that Grinch, and it's not so horrible after all, right?
Oh, says you. Who didn't have to live through it.
Listen, you don't have to be a Whovillian to feel a little pain in your heart, okay, Missy?
Oh, you want to feel some pain? And feel that and...
I'm gonna get my story. I'm gonna get it. Whether it's snow or sleet or...
Sorry. Where you've just been was... Well, let's just say the Grinch was Dr. Seuss's favorite character. Well, maybe second favorite? He loved the Christmas of years past and felt sad it was becoming more about selling than feeling. The Grinch was his way of getting an office chance.
How very clever of Dr. Seuss to sort of slide the moral in sideways.
Absolutely.
Okay, so the Grinch has cheered him up. He loves that everything's fabulous, right?
Professionally, yes. Personally, no.
What?
The late 1960s were very tough on Dr. Seuss. Helen, his wife, friend, and advisor for 40 years, passed away. Within a year, so did his father. Dr. Seuss was despondent, unable to find consolation even in his work. Until a friend, Audrey, suggested. When you're trying to overcome something, you should stand on your head and look at things that way.
Sounds like something Dr. Seuss would say.
Exactly. They fell in love and got married. And Audrey noted early on, in Ted Geisel, there's a wild little kid.
Thank you.
He'd been struggling for 9 months on a book about ecology. Oh. And Audrey suggested they take a vacation to Africa.
Very nice.
The trip was a cat.
A what? A what?
Hairball.
Hairball. Hair. You all right?
A list. The trip was a catalyst for him. Okay. In Kenya, he was inspired by some odd-looking trees, which reminded him of his own drawings.
And the 15 cents is for...
The next thing he knew, the trees were being felled. Audrey, they're cutting my trees! So he grabbed a hotel laundry slip and scribbled a rough draft of his favorite book, The Lorax.
It's fascinating. And this is for...
In the bucket!
Oh! Place inside 15 cents, a nail, and a snail shell. Signed, the Onceler. Uno, dos, tres. Bye-bye. Hello? Can you tell me what happened to Dr. Seuss's trees?
It all started way back in the days when the grass was still green and the pond was still wet and the clouds were still clean and the song of the Swami swans rang out in space. One morning I came to this glorious place. Then I saw the trees, the truffula trees, the bright colored tufts of the truffula trees. And under the trees I saw brown barbaloots frisking about in their barbaloot suits. I felt a great leaping of love in my heart. I knew
just what I do. I unloaded my cart. In no time at all, I had built a small shop. Then I chopped down a truffular tree with one chop. Mister, I am the Lorax. I speak for the trees. I speak for the trees have no tongues. And I'm asking you, sir, at the top of my lungs, that thing, that horrible thing that I see, what's that thing you've made out of my truffula tree?
This thing is most useful. This thing is a need, a fine something that all people need. It's a shirt, it's a sock,
it's a glove,
it's a hat, but it has other uses. Yes, far beyond that.
Sir, you're crazy. You're crazy with greed. There's no one on earth who would buy that fool's need.
And in no time at all in the factory I built, the whole Wunschler family was working full tilt. We were all knitting needs, just as busy as bees, to the sound of the chopping of truffula trees.
I speak for the trees, and I'll yell and I'll shout for the fine things on earth that are on their way out.
Oh, it's Nature Boy, the Garden Club member.
Yes, I am the Lorax who speaks for the trees, which you seem to be chopping as fast as you please. But I'm also in charge of the brown barbaloots who played in the shade in their barbaloot suits and happily lived eating truffula fruits. Now, thanks to your hacking my trees to the ground, there's not enough truffula fruit to go around.
I see your point. Yes, I do see your point.
They love living here, but I can't let them stay. They'll have to find food, and I hope that they may. Please think about it, won't you?
Things were going just fine all the way down the line when he snuck out of a pipe. He was back with another gripe.
Wunschler, you're making such smogulous smoke. My poor swami swans, why, they can't sing a note. And so, they cannot live here. I am sending them off.
Where will they go?
I don't hopefully know.
And at that very moment, we heard a loud whack. From outside in the fields came the sickening smack of an axe on a tree. Then we saw the tree fall, the very last truffula tree of them all. I'll never forget the grim look on his face when he heisted himself and took leave of this place through a hole in the smog without leaving a trace. And all that the Lorax left here in this mess was a small pile of rocks with one word.
Unless?
Yes, unless.
Unless what?
Unless someone like you cares a whole awful lot, nothing's going to get better. It's not. Catch! It's a truffula seed.
You're in charge of the last of the truffula seeds. And truffula trees are what everyone needs. Plant a new truffula. Treat it with care. Give it clean water and feed it fresh air. Grow a forest. Protect it from axes that hack. Then the Lorax and all of his friends may come back.
Okay. Take time. Get involved. Everybody makes a difference. What's going on over there?
Possibly another butter battle. Come on up and see. It's the Zooks and the Ukes. Butter side up, butter side down. Looks like things are heating up again.
Is that Zooks and Ukes with two O's?
Yes, as in Luke.
As you know, on this side of the wall, we are Ukes. On the far other side of this wall, live the Zooks. In every Zook house, and in every Zook town, every Zook eats his bread with the butter side down. But we Ukes, when we eat, when we breakfast or sup, we spread our bread right with the butter side up. Every Zook must be watched. He has kinks in his soul. That's why, as a young man, I made watching my goal. Watching Zooks for the Zook Watching Border Patrol.
Oh.
one day, a very rude Zook by the name of Anich snuck up and slingshotted my Stickberry switch.
This is getting serious.
I know.
A disagreement over spreading butter the right way.
No, I'm sure Dr. Seuss had more on his mind than two groups muttering over buttering. I made a rhyme.
About time.
Hit me. But now this is the calm before the storm. He's about to make a big point, I'm sure.
You got that right.
My dear boy, you're not to blame. You simply have suffered a minor defeat because your Snickberry switch is a bit obsolete. Their slingshot's more modern. What we need to get is a weapon that's even more moderner yet. So I've ordered the boys in the back room to figure how to build you some such duper slingamajigger.
I marched to the wall with great vim and great vigor. With my triple sling jigger, I sure felt much bigger.
My jigger rocks, snatch 'em. We'll fling 'em right back just as fast as we catch 'em.
They thought up a great one. They certainly did. They thought up a gun called the Kickapoo Kid, which they loaded with powerful poo-a-doo powder and axe eggs and bee's legs and dried fried clam chowder.
Shoot if you must with your wee tidy shooter. The boys in my back room have rendered it neuter. With this eight-nozzled elephant-toted boom blitz, it shoots high-explosive sour cherry stone pits and will put your dumb Kickapoo Kid on the fritz.
Those boys in the back room sure knew how to putter. They made me a thing called the Utterly Sputter. But Vanitch had a sputter exactly like mine, and he yelled,
"My blue gooer is working just fine."
My boys made me a gadget that's newer than new. It's filled with mysterious moo like a moo and can blow all those zooks to Salamagoo. They invented the bitchy big boy boomeroo. Vanitch, here's the end of your terrible town, full of zooks who eat bread with the butter side down.
And I, my dear chap, have a message for you. Mainly, I also have a big boy boomeroo. I will blow you into pork and wee beans. I'll butter side up you to small smithereens.
Grandpa, be careful. Oh, gee. Who's gonna drop it? Will you or will he?
Be patient. We'll see. We will see.
Dr. Seuss took a tremendous amount of criticism for this book.
Why?
Seuss was accused of frightening children.
Oh, right. Like robo-terminating aliens don't frighten children, and Dr. Seuss does. Besides, children should be aware of what's happening around them.
Everybody should.
Yeah. Tell me something. Which side did Dr. Seuss butter his bread on?
The edge. So, how's your notebook? Filling up?
My notebook in my head. I hope I don't forget anything.
Well, I have a hunch you'll remember more than you think. Say bye to Norval.
Okay. Bye, Norval.
In his 70s and 80s, he spent a lot of time in and out of hospitals, battling cancer, a heart attack, and eye disease. But he kept on working 8 hours a day, 7 days a week.
He's creative and working in his 80s? Gives me something to live for.
He was once offered a huge sum for the use of his characters in a commercial. This would have put him in the Guinness Book of Records as the highest paid writer per word ever.
You're kidding, Anne.
He replied, "I would rather be in the Guinness Book of Records as the writer who refused the highest amount of money per word."
How cool. What else?
His characters were like family to him. He also liked to sing in karaoke bars.
What?
Just kidding. Seeing whether you're listening.
I am.
His life was his work, and his work was never done. It was only at this point in his life he could write the book, Oh, the Places You'll Go, in which he took a look at the ups and downs of the entire human experience.
Not gonna do it. Not gonna go in the revolving door.
Mine originally. Come on. Trust me.
I've been catnapped. Call 911. Here we go.
works every time. You've changed.
I guess I have. And so, have you.
Everyone is just waiting. Everyone is just waiting. Waiting for a train to go, the phone to ring, the snow to snow. Waiting around for a yes or a no, or just waiting for their hair to grow.
Everyone is just waiting. Everyone is just waiting. Waiting for the fish to bite, or waiting around for a Friday night. A string of pearls, a pair of pants, a wig with coils, or another chance.
But that's not for you.
My George, I think you're right.
Potato.
I'd love to.
Oh, the places you'll go, there is fun to be done, and there are games to be won. I said, oh. To you.
No!
You'll come down from a lurch with an unpleasant bump.
Ouch.
And the chances are then you're gonna be in a slump.
And when I'm in a slump, I'm not in for much fun. Unslumping myself is very difficult. Well, it's not easily done. Oh! The places I'll go.
You'll be best of the best. You tap out a rest.
I said, oh!
Your sneakers may leak.
Ew, but will I succeed?
Yes, yes, you will indeed. 98.75% guaranteed.
Oh!
Draws a tray, and I don't mean a 747.
Kickball change, kickball change. God, I'm a dancer, a dancer, dancers. Oh! Oh, my.
Before you run off.
Run off? I'm having too good of time. Do I have to go?
Not till you scamper over here to see something very special. It's the fossilized footprint of a dinosaur.
Oh, my goodness.
Approximately 150 million years old. His father gave it to him when he was in his 20s.
What a great present.
It was to remind him that even though we might become extinct, we all have the opportunity to leave our footprint in the sand.
I think he left more than a footprint.
Before he was to put his typewriter away for good, he'd written 50 books and sold over 100 million copies, translated into 20 languages and Braille.
What did he care most about?
Turning. Illiteracy. Lack of witteracy. That's what made him mad, angry, furious, curious. He predicted cultural disintegration, life as a third-rate nation. Only the parents could save the day, he would say. Fill the house with stacks of books. Pile them on the sofa, the TV, in every cranny, and all the nooks.
He knew the average kid would pick up a book,
find something interesting. Pretty soon, he'd be reading. He wrote this in his later years.
How did it get so late so soon? It's night before it's afternoon. December's here before it's June. My goodness, how the time has flown. How did it get so late so soon? Listen, I want to apologize for, you know, how I came in earlier and I was acting just very...
beastly.
Crabby.
Angry.
Tired.
P.O.'d.
I was stressed out.
Yeah, well, you're a journalist. What do you expect?
Wait a minute. How could it still be 4:30? Hey, did you see that this... Hello? Where'd you go now? Bye-bye, my friend. And thank you, Dr. Seuss. I had a great time. I got a great story. It has been quite wild.
I hope for the children a world of peace and that they never lose their sense of wonder and discovery. From there to here, from here to there, funny things are everywhere.
King of-